The following podcast contains spoilers for Triple Frontier, The Autopsy of Jane Doe, and Jordan Peele's Us. You have been warned.
Welcome back, everybody, to KeystoneFilmReview.org, or com, or whatever it is. It's not even a website at this point.
No, it's not.
But we're back. It's me.
Ain't nobody got money for that.
Glenjamin Button and our friendly, actual host, Miguel Migusto.
How are you? We're both hosts. We're both hosts. You're co-hostess.
I feel like we go through this every time I did.
Yeah. I'm good. How are you?
This is a little peachy. I got a big surprise for you.
Oh, yeah?
Big surprise for you. Guess how many movies I saw this week?
One.
Lies. Let me give you a little backstory into my week. Monday night. It was just before dawn, around 7 o'clock. I was cooking some food and burned the shit out of my hand. So I couldn't play any goddamn video games all week. All I could do is really watch some shit. So I watched 9 movies.
9? Oh my god. Okay, yeah, that's a...
2 of which...
That's impressive.
...were our movies. So...
Okay, so...
Let me go through the list here.
You're jumping the gun here. Because I got a question for you. The 2015 movie Creed is a spinoff of which successful movie series?
It's definitely Rocky and Bullwinkle.
Yep, exactly. I'm actually, so far, I've been very disappointed with this trivia pack, and it better get good.
I feel like you're just giving me the easier ones.
I'm not. I'm going from top to bottom. It's a deck of cards. I hope that my parents didn't pay too much for that. Knowing them, it was probably just a, like, 50-cent thing.
It was probably, like, $15.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Anyway, get on to your movies, buddy.
Anyway... So I called out of work on Tuesday and sat down because somebody was fixing our water heater. I sat down and I cranked out the Alien trilogy. One, two, and three. It was my first time watching the third one. It wasn't as bad as people give it shit for.
It definitely wasn't
the least David Fincher movie I've ever seen, though.
The least David Fincher movie.
Exactly.
Because I'm sure if you went through all of movies... that weren't directed by David Fincher, you could find one that's less David Finchery.
Most likely. But, I cranked that out. I already saw the other two, so it wasn't that big of a deal. And then I watched Triple Frontier with Kira. And then, by myself, I watched Autopsy of Jane Doe. We'll get to those ones later. Mm-hmm. And then I watched Charles Bronson's Death Wish for the first time. For the first half of the movie, I'm like, I don't understand what the big deal is about. Why is this have such a cult following? And then the other half, I was like, okay, I can get behind it a little bit. But, I saw that. And then I watched an animated film called Batman Bad Blood. It was okay. It was good. Onward. And then I saw Us yesterday, which we'll get to later. And then last one I watched last night, Game Night, with Jason Bateman, Rachel McAdams, and a lot of other people. Man, that was a lot of fun. That was a good movie.
That is a good movie, yeah. Yeah, it's, I'm proud of you. It looks like you and I switched today, because I only saw, other than the movies we're going to be discussing today, one movie.
What the hell's wrong with you?
What the hell? A lot is wrong with me.
Actually having a life and no burnt hands.
Yeah. Only movie that I watched that was not in our series was Happy Death Day to You, which is the sequel to Happy Death Day.
Apologize for you.
You know what? It's okay, because as much as I hated the first one, this one wasn't bad. I feel like they went more with the comedic route with this one.
I was going to say, this one looked like they made more fun of than anything.
Yeah, definitely. They absolutely made more fun of it. So it was, in my opinion, it was more enjoyable. It kind of made me want to rewatch the first one, see if I watch it with, you know, those eyes that if I would like it more.
Yeah.
Yeah, it wasn't terrible. Nothing to text home about, as we say.
Yeah, but still, it's one of those two movies. Well, not one of both of those movies I have no regard in my life ever seeing. So if you recommend it, I swear to Christ.
Well, I can guarantee that they are at least better than Spring Breakers. So we won't want to kill ourselves if we watch them. But other than that, you know, I watched Us, but we decided after discussing that we want to add that to this discussion today, including spoilers. So without further ado, let's get into it. We're going to get into our movies, but we are going to put Us at the back because honestly, it deserves to be last.
Yeah.
And you can take that any way you want.
For a second, I thought you were talking about Us. I'm like, wait, we're putting our movies in the back?
No. We're putting Jordan Peele's Us.
This is the kind of movie he makes, the one that fucks with us, even though we're not talking about it.
Exactly. So, we will get into your movie, Triple Frontier.
First things first, any man here that wants to walk away can do so knowing they're the best of us. This gotta be now. There is no ground support. The injuries we sustain, we're walking out with. Make no mistake about it. You guys need to own the fact that we do not have the flag on our shoulders. You cannot go back to your normal life after tonight.
Directed by J.C. Chander. Triple Frontier, synopsis here says, loyalties are tested. Oh, wait, is this the really long fucking synopsis? It looks like they dragged it down. Good. Loyalties are tested when five former Special Forces operatives reunite to steal a drug lord's fortune, unleashing a chain of unintended consequences. That is so much shorter than what I read last week. I don't know what happened in the week. They probably heard our podcast and was like, you know what? He's right.
You're right.
Okay. It stars Ben Affleck, Oscar Isaac, Charlie Hunnam, and a couple more people. Pedro Pascal, and I forget the one dude's last name, or first name. Ben Miller, that's it. So, yeah.
Ben Miller is the character's name. You mean Garrett Hedlund? Yeah, Garrett Hedlund.
Shit. Garrett Hedlund. Looking at the wrong side.
Yeah, and, you know, J.C. Chandor, or Chander, or however you want to say it, he... I looked back at his, filmography, and he's actually made a lot of movies that I really, really enjoy. And by a lot, I mean two.
But still, yes.
His past two have been some of my favorite movies in recent years. All Is Lost with Robert Redford.
Yep.
And A Most Violent Year with Jessica Chastain and Oscar Isaac. And, had I seen that going in, I probably would have been more excited for this movie.
Oh, it's a nice little surprise, though, afterwards.
Yeah, definitely. And honestly, this movie feels nothing like those movies.
It does not.
So I'm not sure exactly, you know, how this went down. But, yeah. I mean, this is making it sound like I didn't like the movie, but it compared to those two, yes. It's definitely lacking.
Yeah. So, yeah, we'll start off with the cast there. If that's not a big old the bro force of people right there, I don't know what is.
That is indeed a bro force, yeah.
I think this is Ben Affleck post-rehab. I don't know if that has anything to do with it. Just a statement. I was talking to somebody at work about it, and she's like, this movie was the shit. I was like, are you sure? She's like, yeah, you got to watch it. I'm like, well, that's the plan. I got a podcast. We're going to talk about it. We're going to spread some words about the good Bible. And then maybe and she loved that movie. She was hype about it. And I was like, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, you're getting me a little hype, but I'm going to stay at my pace and stay calm. And I really enjoyed this movie. I'm not going to lie. Definitely the cast was what made me like it the most.
Yeah.
Because other than that, it's a very, very simple story.
Very simple but frustrating story.
Yes.
Like, it's one of those things where if I were in their situation, I would probably do everything the exact same way. But watching it as like a fly on the wall, you're like, you idiot. Mm-hmm. What are you doing?
Yeah. Like I said, it's a very simple story. There's no, let's go to 6,000 places where, hey, we're in Peru. Next thing you know, we're in Moscow. And next thing you know, it's they go straight to Mexico.
Yeah. And
they're pretty much in Mexico the whole time. So it's just one, like...
I thought it was Colombia.
Right. You're right.
Yeah.
Is it? Yeah. Whatever.
Yeah. I'm fairly certain it's Colombia.
Regardless, it's just straight up one whole storyline. And this, to me, this game, or wow, this game, fuck. This movie felt a lot like there's a Ghost Recon game called Wildlands, and it reminded me a lot of that. But I'm not going to get into that other than just what it felt like to have this force of people, and you're just going through like this cartel and just stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So it was really cool to like revisit that along the lines of how I felt while playing a game in a similar sense. I'll let you speak a little bit. I'm talking a lot. Go for it.
I definitely agree with you. It's a great cast. They all did a really good job at making themselves, stick out among the rest. Like none of them were really in movies like this. You kind of group some people up in like the same mentality just because they have similar personalities, but they all had different enough personalities where they're all memorable characters to some extent, and definitely some more than others, but that's just because of screen time and all that, and their arcs were completely believable, you know, overall from beginning to end. I had a problem with the writing. I feel like the writing was definitely kind of weak. As far as dialogue, you know, granted, I might have gone in with kind of looking for the flaws, because one of the first things is Charlie Hunnam. This is because of the movie, not because of me. Like, I went in with an open mind, and then in like the first 5 minutes, Charlie Hunnam, or Hunnam, however you pronounce Hunnam, he's giving a speech to a bunch of other veterans. And he does that stupid cliche, "I was the best of the best." And once I heard that, I was like, ugh, okay, it's going to be that kind of movie. That definitely took me out of it. But it was definitely an enjoyable movie. But I did have problems with the writing. It's just, I really enjoyed how they pointed out multiple times the shitty treatment of veterans. You know, like they kept pointing out how Ben Affleck was shot 5 times and, he's struggling to make ends meet, which is absolutely true. This country treats their veterans like shit and then uses them as like a platform for politics and then does absolutely nothing about that for like once the people are elected.
I've actually met a few people who themselves have complained about it. Like, it's actually a real thing. Like, they talk about, not just like, hey, this movie, we're going to talk about it. It's bullshit.
Well, no, it's absolutely bullshit. I mean, everyone brings up homeless veterans, but then they want to spend more money on war instead of helping veterans. Mm-hmm. Like, what the hell is wrong with you? I really enjoyed that they brought that aspect to it. It definitely made it believable why they would want to rob this drug lord. And brought everything, you know, into a realistic light, more or less, for what it was.
And since you brought the drug lord up, I did want to talk about that. They did a great job at characterizing everybody, at least through the main cast. But when it came to like the drug lord, he was kind of just like this just bad guy. It's like, hey, we're gonna go after him because he's a terrible guy, and they don't go any further into the backstory other than like he's got a family that he sends to church on Sundays and he stays at home, and that's really it. They just really know that he's a bad guy.
They try to assume that you are just gonna put like Pablo Escobar in there or whatever, you know, and even casting wise, or at least in the way they shot it, it's kind of, he's shot in a way, you know, cinematically shot, not like shot with a gun, in a way that once they do kill him, you're not really sure if that was him. Like they don't really focus on him long enough for you to know for a fact if that's Larea or not.
Yeah. It would have been nice to like, because, like, during the time, you like, you know he's the bad guy, you know he's the typical bad guy, but it would have been nice to see, like, how bad of a guy he was other than stealing money or knowing that he steals money from the towns and stuff like that. Just to see how bad he was and see how much he deserves getting all the shit stolen from him and his so on and so forth happening to him. I think that would have definitely benefited with this movie. Other than that, it was just, like, a typical, oh, this is a drug lord and he steals money. And we're going to take that money.
Yeah, okay. I think, you know, it definitely has its flaws. I'm not a huge fan of Charlie Hunnam if he has to do an American accent. I feel like he has a really weak American accent. That's just me personally.
I've been stuck on his accent since watching Sons of Anarchy, so it's yeah, all the same to
like,
me.
Like, I really wish that they they had a lot of people cast. Tom Hardy was meant to be in this. I don't know what role, but Tom Hardy.
Yeah, I forgot about there's a lot.
Channing Tatum, Johnny Depp, Tom Hanks. They also had Mahershala Ali. Could you imagine this with Mahershala Ali?
It would have been fantastic.
Leonardo DiCaprio, Denzel Washington, Sean Penn.
And what's crazy is you got all that other star power, and I feel like this mm-hmm. still had enough star power on it that was still good for what it was.
Yeah.
Sure, it would have been fantastic to see all those other dudes in there, but, I mean, this movie worked out great for what they had for
these guys.
It's, not saying that these, like, they had to fucking pick these guys, like, oh, this is what we got, but still.
No, I mean, Ben Affleck and Oscar Isaac are your two most famous people in this movie.
Yeah.
Followed shortly by Charlie Hunnam, but then, like, Pedro Pascal and Garrett Hedlund. I mean,
Pedro is really more well-known for Game of Thrones than anything.
Yeah. Well, I wouldn't know, but I didn't know he was in Game of Thrones until just now.
Other than that, I think he was in Wall of China with Matt Damon.
He's also in the second Kingsman movie.
That's right, yeah. Oh, wait, was he in Game of Thrones? Now I'm questioning myself. I'm pretty sure he's in Game of Thrones.
He is. He plays Oberyn Martell. Oberyn Martell, yeah.
Gave myself a heart attack.
The thing that bugged me a lot about this movie is, again, I mentioned it before, like, it makes sense, but it's just really frustrating seeing people be so stupid in a movie.
Yeah.
Where you're just like, if there's more money than you thought there was, and you're getting close to your time,
mm-hmm.
take the money that you came for and just leave. Like, your entire buildup is about how dangerous these people are and how you don't want the family to get involved at all. And then you completely abandon that just because you see a bunch of money. Like, I'm not saying it's not realistic, but like,
oh yeah.
I would have rathered, because the way it happens is Ben Affleck spends all this time like saying, this is our plan. We're not going to change from this plan.
Mm-hmm. And everybody's on board with it.
Yeah, and then I would have rathered it been anyone but Ben Affleck trying to stick behind.
Yeah, it would have made like more a bit of a stretch to me. For Garrett Hedlund's character, maybe?
Yeah, Garrett Hedlund and even, like, Charlie Hunnam, maybe Oscar Isaac a little bit.
Maybe Oscar Isaac if he wanted to give the money back to the towns and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, for Ben Affleck's character, it was really frustrating.
It was like, it was a complete 180. It's like, did you not listen to yourself? Like, you played...
Because I don't think we explained it too much, because his character throughout the whole movie is this dude who's headstrong. He's got a head on his shoulders that's got a plan for whatever situation they're going to do.
Yeah.
And when they finally come up with this plan, he's like, this is what we're doing. This is what we're sticking with. And we're not doing anything other than that.
Yeah.
And then when it comes down to it, they're ripping the walls down, getting the money and stuff like that. And then he's like, we got 2 more minutes. We're okay. We're going to get more money. We're going to fill up these vans and we're going to have some more on our backs and we're going to keep going. And he's just yelling at his team because they're like, no, this was the plan, like, to get out as soon as we had enough. And he's just like, no, there's more money. We need to get it.
Yeah.
It was completely frustrating.
It definitely would have been way more believable if that arc, even with him having like a quick trigger finger when they crash land in that village, it would have made much more sense and probably been more impactful if they switched from the raid on Ben Affleck and Garrett Hedlund's character.
Yeah.
And full disclosure, as we said in the beginning, there are spoilers for this. Ben Affleck does end up dying. I feel like it probably would have been more impactful with him dying had he not done all that stuff. Because it's at that point, it's like, this is your fault, man. But had Garrett Hedlund done all of that and then Ben Affleck died, I feel like that would have had more of an impact.
Yeah.
Or even Oscar Isaac, like anyone other than him.
See, I'm really partial about all this because for the first half of the movie, you're like, everything's going way too fucking good. Something's got to happen. And then, of course, Ben Affleck does this 180. And then even after that, it just goes to shit show after the raid on the house, which I really enjoyed. I did have a problem, obviously, with Ben Affleck's character doing the 180. But I thought at the same time, when his character did end up getting shot by one of the villagers' kids, I was like, because it made you not only kind of not care, but at the same time care a little bit. I thought it was nice because you got these conflicting things. You're like, okay, he was a good dude, but then he was a shitty dude.
Yeah, and he's also like, leaving a family behind, but yeah. Also this is his fault.
And even, I don't remember if it was Oscar Isaac, but the whole team really was just sitting there like, man, he did a really shitty fucking thing, but like he was this good dude before all this.
Yeah.
And it really makes you think, man, about a lot of situations like that.
I just kind of wish they dwelled more on that.
Yeah.
I felt like they kept trying to just shrug it off and move forward.
Yeah, so I'm not saying that it like wasn't a problem with the writing it didn't suck, but it's also like, okay, at the same time, I thought that's kind of cool.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm partial. I'm like 50-50 on it. Yeah. But maybe that was the intention.
Definitely. The one thing I think this movie did really well was keeping it fresh. Like, it wasn't just a heist movie.
Yeah.
You know, they went for the heist. They make you think that the climax of the movie is an hour into the movie when it's 2 hours, 5 minutes. And then they keep going. They keep going with this helicopter that there is not enough weight to get, or they have too much weight to get over the mountains. Yeah, so then they add that to it.
This whole thing is Ben Affleck's fault.
It really is. But like they did a really good job of keeping it fresh. You know, not staying in one place too long, not making it feel safe for too long, and other than the beginning, but you kind of had to build that up to get to the point. But yeah, I think overall it's a decent movie. I always feel bad worse for animals than I do for humans when they die. Like,
oh,
I felt
man,
worse
that
for,
scene sucked.
I felt worse for the donkey when he fell off the cliff than I did Ben Affleck dying.
And they even brought that up when it happened. Mm-hmm. They're like, why the fuck are you laughing? That was an animal, man. And then they were like, well, that could have been us, or the other way around. That was nice because you never really hear that in like movies. Like, you never hear people being sympathetic towards something like that.
Yeah.
And I want to go back to the Ben Affleck's part where he dies. Mm-hmm. I was kind of really frustrated with that because throughout the whole thing, you can hear more than one gunshot. Like, there's definitely two shooters. And these guys are all military trained, right?
Yeah.
And so, was it Ben Affleck that took down one dude, or was it somebody else? I can't remember.
I think it was... it might have been
Ben Affleck. Somebody took down one of the shooters, but as soon as that shooter was taken out, Ben Affleck decided to sit down and just kind of breathe because they were all running up rocky hills. Sits down, gets, boom, shot in the head. That pissed me off. Because you don't take a break.
Not only that, but
when you're military trained gunfire.
Not only that, but he turned around to look at the person without pointing his gun.
Yeah.
Like, that's, I feel like that's military 101. So if you're going to turn, your gun is pointing where you're turning.
So yeah, me, logically, I'm not even military trained. And I know for a fact, instinctually, like for military trained people, they would be more than ready to turn around with their gun in their hand than just,
yeah.
Like fucking insert Tim Allen, that really made me mad.
Yeah.
And I'm not even military trained. I'm like, all right, listen, come on, instincts.
Yeah, I felt like that was really weak. I felt like at that point it was just trying to be forced.
Yeah.
One thing I did love, though, after that, when they're trying, you know, after Ben Affleck's dead, they dumped the majority of the money into that canyon that no one's going to be able to go to. They're just trying to get out alive. And I love that Oscar Isaac just tries to, they do that escape without trying to kill anybody. I felt like that was a really nice change from action movies where everyone's just like, oh, you gotta kill that person, kill that person. They're just trying to they're trying to detain them without, or stop them without killing them. I thought that was really cool.
Oscar Isaac's character was really good in this movie because he was sympathetic to more than just his crew. He was sympathetic to all the people that were getting robbed and shit like that. And they do a really good job throughout the whole movie of him interacting with people and being like, hey, like, I'm sorry this is going on. Here's money for your troubles and stuff like that. And then before that, there's, he's got like this informant and like he's really tight with her and he's like really cool. He's like, I'll cut your brother out, I swear to God.
Yeah.
So that's not Oscar Isaac's voice at all, but still. Yeah. So like his, that was one of my favorite parts of the whole movie is his character. And I know we didn't really touch on it much. The cinematography in this movie, man.
It's great. It's fantastic.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
There's like one specific like drone shot where this like this mountain highway that was like, I was just like, God damn. God damn. All right.
Funnily enough, the cinematographer Roman Vasyanov, he was a cinematographer for Fury, which is fantastic.
Ah.
And also Suicide Squad.
Uh-huh.
Which, if I have to say anything nice about Suicide Squad, is that it was nice to look at most of the time. But, you know, the story and the acting was just terrible, so.
What else can I really say about this movie? Like, yes, it was really fresh. It was, some of the characters were really nice. They did a little 180 that people didn't care too much about, but I feel like it was intended for the purpose of feeling conflicted. I really enjoyed this movie. I don't love it beyond belief.
Yeah.
I think they set it up kind of for a sequel that people are like talking about. Like, I've talked to some people.
It ends with Charlie Hunnam giving Oscar Isaac a paper with coordinates written on it.
Yeah.
Which they don't say, but you know it's the coordinates of the canyon that they dumped the money into. Mm-hmm. So. Or at least it's heavily implied.
So they kind of set it up for a sequel, and I really, really hope they don't do it.
Yeah, same here.
Personally, because A, I could maybe see Oscar Isaac going, but I don't see the other ones going. Because at the end of the movie, they all give their money to Ben Affleck and his family, which, I mean, Ben Affleck's dead. So they just give it to Ben Affleck's family. So I don't see that whole crew going. Maybe Oscar Isaac. But if he was smart, he wouldn't really go for that money, even though it's a lot of goddamn money.
Yeah. I kind of would have preferred if they just had like a montage of him finding it and then giving it to like the town or something.
Hell,
or
some end credit of that. I would have preferred an end credit scene. I didn't look for an end credit scene, but still.
Me neither, but I doubt there is. Usually on Netflix there isn't. And if there is, it won't try to prompt you to go to the next movie, which with this one it did.
I hope they don't do a sequel. Generally, I know a lot of people I've talked to would seem excited for a sequel.
The thing is, a lot of people get excited for sequels, and then when it comes out, they're like, "That wasn't as good as the first one." It's like, "Well, of course
they got
not.
These expectations. You can't."
Yeah, it's not. So that's really my biggest problem with people trying to constantly build franchises. Like, no, leave it at a standalone. It's great as a standalone. You don't need to continue.
Oh, what I did want to say, the reason why I picked this movie is it did remind me a lot of Sicario. And in my head, this did a better job than Sicario. Even though they're technically, obviously, two whole different movies.
Yeah.
But I feel like that's tough to say. I was going to say if I had to pick over Sicario and this, I'd probably pick this. But they're two whole different movies. I can't even say anything.
I'd have to rewatch the first Sicario. I was really disappointed in it, and it really kind of annoyed me. But I do admit that it was masterfully made.
Yeah.
Sicario 2 was a complete disappointment, and I am pissed off that they even made it. But so I would definitely say this is better than Sicario 2. But
except for that cinematography in Sicario.
Well, yeah, cinematography. I think it's Roger Deakins.
It's Roger Deakins, so you can't even.
He's fantastic.
But yeah, that's the reason I did pick this movie. I was like, it reminds me a lot of Sicario. I want to take a gander. And then it didn't disappoint me at all. So it was a nice little fresh movie. I liked it. I'm your masters
of war. The question is, do we finally get to use our skills for our own benefit? We're going to get Gabriel Martin Larea. He's got over $75 million in cash.
If we're not gone forever after you make your move, we are dead.
We need to hunt quickly. Is your money
that good? You cannot say.
They will find us.
It's always a little harder than you think it's going to be.
We don't need mansions like that.
This is not what I signed up for.
A lot of people are going to come after you.
So we go through.
Let's move on to the autopsy of Jane Doe.
This is not what I was expecting.
Can I see one?
No.
What's that for?
Make sure he's dead.
Sheriff, what happened?
No ID, no fingerprints in the system.
For now, she's a Jane Doe.
He needs my help right now. 11 o'clock, I'm all yours.
Directed by Andre Overdahl and written by Ian Goldberg and Richard Nang, starring Brian Cox, Emile Hirsch, Ophelia Lavabond, and Olwyn Catherine Kelly. The Autopsy of Jane Doe tells the story of a father and son. Both coroners are pulled into a complex mystery while attempting to identify the body of a young woman who was apparently harboring dark secrets. So yeah, that's the Autopsy of Jane Doe. And I watched this. I started this at midnight.
Ooh, spooky.
And you have seen the hallways of my apartment complex.
Yeah.
And I tell you that I was super paranoid after I
It's some serious The Shining shit going on in Mike's apartment complex.
And it's every time I know it's just my mentality, but every time I watch a movie like this, I just feel like something's following me.
Absolutely.
I had to take Peanut out to take her to, you know, go to the bathroom and everything. And it was just so creepy. There's also this tree in our courtyard that looks like a person just hunched over standing there. And I know it's there, but it gets me every time. And I just keep looking at it every time this happens.
Absolutely.
So, you know, I don't normally get freaked out or scared in movies. You know, things definitely creep me out, but I'm never just like paranoid after this, but this made me paranoid after watching it. Can we talk about Brian Cox?
Can we talk about Brian Cox and Emile Hirsch?
And Emile Hirsch.
The chemistry between those two in this movie is insane.
Oh yeah, they had fantastic chemistry. But Brian Cox, I feel like, I don't know if this is true, but I feel like he's classically trained. And he does a lot of movies like this that really someone who's as good of an actor as him shouldn't have to be in. You know, not to knock him or his career, but like, I feel like he chose to do this movie because he believed in it, and he really brought his A game.
Oh, which he knocked this shit out of the park. Yeah. He's fantastic.
Like it says in the synopsis, they're both coroners, and he's kind of training Emile Hirsch to become a coroner. Who doesn't really want to become a coroner, but you know, he knows a lot about it. And like you said, their chemistry is just impeccable throughout the entire thing. I had no problem believing that they were father and son.
It was crazy. Like, it's a horror movie. You don't really expect. I mean, most of the time you do expect chemistry like this. Like, I'd say the chemistry would rival Conjuring's, like Patrick Wilson and it's not Vera Farmiga, is it? Whatever.
With The Conjuring?
Yeah.
That's Vera Farmiga.
The Warrens? All right, sweet. I would say they were just, like, even on par with those two. Like, it was...
Definitely.
Like, they were fantastic together.
Yeah.
And obviously, the cast is so small, so it was nice to have those two really bring it home.
Absolutely. I honestly didn't write too many notes for this, just because I was so enthralled in the movie the entire time.
Yeah, I'm still on my streak of writing no notes.
Yeah, you know, I feel like I've been getting into movies more without writing the notes, so I might try to limit my note writing.
It's nice to do.
Only
Kind of just enjoy
only
it.
Because
if you hate it's going to stick in your goddamn head.
Two of my notes are Hello Nightmares and a whole bunch of Nope. Those are two of my notes. But yeah, I think it just did. It does a very fantastic job. First of all, I'm not a coroner, but I felt like I was watching two coroners go through their motions.
Yeah. Like this movie, like they did their research on what they had to do. Like they were going through all the motions of what they do during an autopsy and like like downstairs and their whole basement setup, everything.
Yeah,
this movie did its research.
It definitely did, and it kept it interesting too. They didn't they didn't stick too much with the scientific notion. They add the emotional element that I feel like if this weren't a horror movie and it was just a normal. If it were any other of the bodies they did an autopsy on, it probably would have been more scientific.
Yeah.
But because, they kept finding these crazy mysteries and everything, it definitely did a good job at showing their emotional reaction to the oddity that was happening.
Yeah, my favorite part is they're pulling something new out and they're like, what the fuck? There's no way this should be happening to her. What the? All right, let me look it up real quick.
Yeah, and well, that's the thing. Like Emil Hirsch definitely jumped to conclusions more, but the entire time they were trying to be scientific about it, like to the point where when something weird would happen, Brian Cox would be like, "Well, that's weird. That shouldn't happen now." But I have seen this happen.
Instead of giving up on it, they were just like. All right, there's got to be something else here. Let me look at the next. Let me look at her toenails or something like that.
I think one of the most memorable parts is when they first cut her open. Like blood just completely flows out of her, and they know she's been dead for a while. And Emil Hirsch is like, they shouldn't bleed like that. And Brian Cox is like, I've seen that happen in a fresh body if there's a lot of buildup, but with how. He's not completely convinced that it's paranormal.
Yeah.
But he is just like, okay, this is
like everything he does has an explanation or like he's like, all right, well, I understand this, but it's weird.
it's weird that it's happening in this body, but I have seen it happen before.
Yeah.
And I really thought that was just, incredible detail. And they didn't just completely. I mean, even to the point where until Brian Cox sees a ghost, he's like, there's got to be an explanation to this.
Yeah.
And then he sees someone that they pulled him out of the drawer before. He knows that person's dead and they're walking around. He's like, oh, okay. This is spooky.
There's got to be an explanation for this.
Yeah. I you don't see that a lot in horror movies. People just jump to conclusions right away. It just did a fantastic job. They even from the get-go when they open with that police scene, crime scene, where they find the body of Jane Doe and she's in like buried in the ground. And there's the dead bodies around her, and they just do a real good job at like letting you know that something's not right.
Yeah.
And I personally, I knew something was, I thought it was going to lean more towards like a satanic sacrifice or whatever.
Yeah. And that's what they were leaning for too. When they were pulling some stuff out, they're like, maybe this is some satanic shit.
Yeah. But then they completely did this really caught me off guard in a good way that, they kind of figured out that she was one of the witches that was, tortured and killed in the Salem witch trials.
Yeah.
And that was just crazy. I mean, I it's one of those things that like I didn't see come, but it completely made sense afterwards. I don't know how else to explain it.
No.
it's a crazy movie, but it makes sense the entire
time. We don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. Where's Brian Cox? They kept mentioning like up north. Too, when they said that like she has peat in her nails, and I thought they were going to be in like the South throughout the entire movie, but they're in the end they show that one of the cars has a Pennsylvania license plate. So I mean,
oh shit,
New England is north compared to Pennsylvania, so we're it really still close. Makes sense. But yeah,
we're really close.
We live in a spooky state.
So yeah, beyond the. beyond the chemistry between Brian Cox and Emile Hirsch, I do want to say my absolute favorite part about this movie, which for a huge good portion of the movie had me just was like, this is going to be set up to be one of the greatest horror movies, because they did something so new that, well, no, I wouldn't say new, but they did something so well that you're just sitting there like, this is how a horror movie is done. So when they bring said witch into the autopsy room, Olwyn Catherine Kelly is the chick's name. Nothing, that she doesn't move, she doesn't flinch. Like, you're focused entirely on this movie, on her doing something, but the whole movie she's just sitting there, just laying dead. She's dead as fuck. She ain't moving this whole movie. It's just the things that happened around them. And I thought that was so well done, because this whole movie, you're paying attention to what she could possibly be doing when it's just everything around her that's happening, instead of like, because too many movies have done this thing where like, oh, her foot moved, or like she's, although I will say they did put her in like a reflection, or maybe it was one of the other dead bodies of a mirror, but like they never showed her body on the platform moving at all. And I thought, I loved that.
The way they cut it together insinuated that she was still alive, which you find out she is still alive in the end. She's just, you know, paralyzed more or less, or in a trance or what have you. But she is still alive, and they do a real good job of just cutting to her face and to kind of hint that, you know, something's going on. And I mean, that's the entire movie. It's not like it's a huge surprise. That's what the movie's about. But you're right. They did absolutely a great job. I would be surprised if she was a dummy. Like, it really kind of felt like, I mean, I know there are definitely some parts where she's a dummy.
Yeah.
But like in the close-ups of her face and everything, she did a great job at like staying still, even though
she seemed dead. Like they put some real strong morphine in her body or something and just like knocked her the fuck out.
Yeah, you never know. But I mean, they did that in the movie Saw too, where Tobin Bell, the very first Saw, you know, it's revealed that he's been the dead body on the ground the entire time. He actually laid on the ground the entire time they shot there, to the point where Lee Wannell was shocked when he stood up. Like, the reaction when Tobin Bell's character is standing up is 100% real, because Lee Wannell, who wrote it, he knew that that was going to happen, but I guess they didn't tell him that that wasn't a dummy. So like when he stood up, he was like,
pretty funny.
Yeah. And I'm sure like he, in his head, he knew what was going on, but like he let his surprise that that was a real body come in, very well. And, you know, I'm kind of curious to see how much of this was just her sitting around laying there. And kudos to her for, you know, doing that while naked.
Yeah, seriously.
How much of that? Like that takes a lot of courage. So,
really does. My only real gripe that I had with this movie is that halfway through, I was totally stoked about the whole thing, and then it started going into some jump scares and stuff like that.
Yeah, I felt like it wasn't as bad as a lot of horror movies, but yeah, I do absolutely know what you're talking about.
And it just, like, you know, obviously the loud noises, people, you know, where like something turns a corner and next thing you know, violins and shit. That was really my only gripe about this movie.
Yeah.
I hate when that happens. And of course, we'll talk later about a different movie that, you know, we'll see.
I the thing I don't understand that they don't do more, I prefer the slow reveal over the jump scare.
Yeah.
Like, specifically at the end, you know, Brian Cox is dead, Emile Hirsch's girlfriend's dead, and you think it's all over. You think that Emile Hirsch is going to be saved because Brian Cox kind of made a pact with Jane Doe.
Yeah.
Where he's like, you can hurt me all you want, please don't hurt him. And then she starts, like, doing everything to him that was done to her, you know, paranormally. And so you think, okay, you know, she's kind of released all this tension. She knows what's up. And you, it's kind of like the beginning of a, as happy of an ending as it can be.
Yeah.
And then you think Emile Hirsch is going to be saved, but then he like turns around and Brian Cox, who is dead, is there. And but they do it with the jump scare. It would have been much better if he's like facing the one way.
Yeah.
And then like slowly turns. I feel like that would have been better. But, you know,
'tis what it is.
Can't win them all.
Yeah. But other than that, I really enjoyed this movie. It was much, much better than I thought it was going to be, considering it. I mean, we watched the trailer for it like two years ago.
Yeah, we watched it a very long time ago, but I really enjoyed it. It's probably one of my favorite horror movies at this point.
Yeah, I didn't really hear anything about it after we watched the trailer, so I just figured it just kind of fell by the wayside, and it was a nice little surprise.
I heard from some of my friends who are really into horror that it was really good, but yeah, other than that, it really fell by the wayside. You know, yeah. I didn't hear much about it.
Subject is in her mid to late 20s. Hair brown. Flood warning now. Eyes gray.
What happened to you?
First, they bound her. Then they ripped out her tongue, poisoned her, paralyzed her, forced her to swallow the cloth.
Where is that?
Dad?
No one could see what we have seen.
So let's move on to Jordan Peele's Us.
That's a classic right there.
What does I got five on it mean?
It's about drugs.
It's not about drugs. It's a dope song. Don't do drugs.
Get in rhythm.
Here you go.
Here you go. Creep on in, on in, on in.
Can't believe how big they've got.
Did you hear Gabe got a boat?
Daddy. He's kidding, right?
He's not kidding.
Hey, I think it's vodka clock.
Oh, yeah.
Where's Jason?
Jason?
Jason!
Where were you? I didn't know if you were lost. Stick with me, and I'll keep you safe.
There's a family in our driveway.
It's probably the neighbors. But y'all scared of a family? Can I help you?
Is he popular enough to call Jordan Peele's Us at this point?
I mean, it's been advertised as that. After Get Out, everything just was put with his name in front of it, really.
Yeah, I mean, he deserves it. He's fantastic. Yeah,
absolutely. So what really funny thing about this is you had texted me in the, not even in the middle, like as soon as I sat down into the movie, you texted me like, are you going to watch Us in time for this podcast? And I didn't text back. I was going to sit there and be like, watch it right now, motherfucker. But I felt like I should pay attention to the full movie, and I text you afterwards. I was absolutely. Like, the end credits are currently running.
Yeah. I did not look at my phone the entire time. But anyway, we're kind of getting ahead of ourselves. Written and directed by Jordan Peele, Us tells the story of a family's serenity turns to chaos when a group of doppelgangers begin to terrorize them. Which, you know, everyone who's seen the trailer knows that. I've been telling people for months that the trailer for Us is the greatest trailer ever made. It is like perfectly edited. There's not a single part of it where I'm just like, well, that looks dumb. Like, it hyped me up from the first watch. I watched the first trailer and did not watch anything else. And It's fantastic, and I'm you know, excited. It's starring Lupita Nyong'o, Winston Duke, Elizabeth Moss, Tim Heidecker, Shahadi Wright Joseph. I apologize if I mispronounced that. Evan Alex. Just a fantastic movie. I'm not even gonna build it up. This is legitimately, technically wise, one of the best movies I have ever seen,
and knocks it out of the park in horror. One of the best horror movies I've ever seen in my goddamn life.
I was nearly brought to tears, not because it's sad and not because it's scary. It is scary, but like the scariness didn't bring me to tears. But like just the way it was made, he put so much detail into foreshadowing, into tying up loose ends, referencing something in the first act and then again in the third act. Like he does it so masterfully that I was like the entire time I was like, "You magnificent bastard." Meanwhile, like tears were building up in my face. Like this is a film nerd's movie, and I have only one gripe with it, which I'll get into later. But other than that, like that one gripe is not enough for me to write it off completely. Like it is, it's a phenomenal movie, and I 100% do not understand why anyone would dislike this movie at all.
Like I'm looking at the IMDb score right now, and it's really honestly pissing me off a little. 7.6 out of 10.
Yeah,
I can understand people. Actually, no, I can't. Why the fuck do you not like this movie, people?
Yeah. And like I can understand people not liking Get Out. Like,
yeah.
I loved Get Out, but I can understand people not liking it. This is 100% a perfect, not writing wise. I will admit the writing did lack in some places, but the way it is made, it is 100% phenomenal. Like it's perfect. It is. Just with shot choices, like there's this just things that are it usually foreshadowing, like slaps you in the face. And I feel like a lot of people probably wouldn't have noticed the foreshadowing if it wasn't so well known what the plot was going to be about. They're like doppelgangers. Like there's this one, they're walking on the beach and there's this over the head shot where you see the family and then you see their shadows. That right there is what the movie's about, is their shadows. It's even Lupita Nyong'o, even her doppelganger mentions that. Can we just also talk about how creepy her voice was as the doppelganger?
If she doesn't get nominated for an Oscar at the very least.
Honestly, like, I know I said this for Annihilation, but I do not foresee a movie beating this out for my favorite movie of the year.
Yeah.
And I kind of hope that I'm right this time. I was pleasantly wrong last time,
but yeah.
with Blind Spotting, but like with Us, like it's just I haven't been that invested in a movie while watching it in years. Like even with Annihilation, even with Blind Spotting, even with the last movie I can probably say I was that invested while watching is probably No Country for Old Men, which was 12 years ago.
Yeah, and it's about time for a new one.
yeah, and. You know, everyone was fantastic in this. Tim Heidecker, who has no right being as good as he was in this movie. Like, he's definitely the comedic relief of this. Like, he's funny. He's a goofy character. Even his doppelganger is kind of goofy. But he was fantastic. Like, he was creepy. He creeped me out. And I know it's just Tim Heidecker. I know it's Spaghetti from the Tim and Eric show. He's just... and the way he does when the doppelganger is changing, the Tim Heidecker doppelganger is chasing Winston Duke and they go on the boat and he just steps on the boat and does that whole fists on his hips thing and just looks around. Oh, my God. That was so fucking funny.
Like a dad cooking a barbecue.
Yeah, it was great. I Elizabeth Moss, for me, when her doppelganger was in the scenes stole the show.
Yeah.
Like there's a scene where her doppelganger is like putting on lip gloss and looking in a mirror. And it really just, you know, emulated just a person or something trying to do what she thinks she's supposed to as a human being. Like it felt like an animal copying a human in a way. And in a way, not to say that this is what this is, but it reminded me of that scene. I don't know if you saw I, Tonya, with Margot Robbie? You didn't?
Nope.
Okay, well, there's a scene where she's, like, having a panic attack, but she's, like, trying to stay happy in the mirror, mm-hmm. and, like, she's, like, putting on her makeup and everything and just smiling. And it reminded me a lot of that, which that was an Oscar-nominated role. So that's all I have to say about that. I'm not saying that she will be Oscar-nominated, but I'm saying it is Oscar-worthy of her performance. My God, this fucking movie.
Seriously.
Yeah.
I guess I'll talk a little bit here. You know?
Yeah.
So after the movie, me and Kira went to breakfast, and she's like, well, what did you think of the movie? I'm like, listen.
I don't know why. I'm sorry. I'm going to stop you. Every time you say listen like that, it's either going to be something really stupid or just really profound. And I'm interested in what it's going to be.
I was like, listen, that shit was fucking perfect. That shit, like, I fucking loved this movie. Like, there wasn't for me a problem with it. At least that maybe I'll watch it another time. I'll probably try to look for some things. I thought this movie fucking fantastic.
Yeah.
The acting alone, the comedic timing with some of the things he had, like the horror aspect of it, like everything was just so damn well done, and it's insane. Jordan Peele's out here on his second movie showing people up who've been doing this shit for years. And it's insane. And my man's been a comedic presence for how long? He's just out here whipping out horror things left and right.
Yeah,
literally, because that's the only two he's got. But still, this movie's insane, and Lupita just brings a performance that's just devastating to my eyes, because I'm like, I've never seen this before. Stop. And just, the whole cast, man, everybody's so good. Like Shahadi Wright Joseph, Evan Alex, Winston Duke. Winston Duke's comedic timing in this movie is just insane.
Winston Duke, I felt like, was playing Jordan Peele.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like there's a lot of it where I was just like, oh yeah, you're just Jordan Peele wrote this character to be him. And the thing I love about that is it wasn't like a cocky way. Like I don't know if you saw Alita Battle Angel.
No.
But one of the characters in that is obviously Robert Rodriguez, and he's like super badass and super romantic and sexy and all that. But in this, he's the biggest goober. He gets injured almost immediately and it's like has to be helped throughout the entire movie. And the honesty of Jordan Peele just being like, yeah, I would need help to survive this. I love that.
It's so good, man.
Yeah.
And then like you said about the foreshadowing right from the beginning. They show you everything that's going to happen. Like the very beginning, it's showing you what's most likely going to happen.
Like the hands across America. Yeah. The whole thing.
Yeah, man. Oh, man. And then that the intro where they're showing the opening credits, the rabbit thing. That was awesome.
Yeah.
At first I was like, okay, this is a little weird. And then it just kept zooming out. And I'm like, oh my Lord.
Yeah.
This is amazing.
What are all those rabbits there for?
But, and like you're sitting there, you're like, I have no fucking idea what rabbits are. The hell are these rabbits?
Yeah.
And then obviously they'll tell you later in the movie, but man, this shit was so good. And then just Lupita holding her goddamn own throughout this whole movie was so impressive. And then you find out at the end of the movie what goes down, and you're like, holy shit. I didn't know this was written and directed by 1990s M. Night Shyamalan. How you doing there, buddy? Well,
see, that was the one problem I had with it. I honestly would have preferred there be no twist.
Yeah.
Or that twist be revealed like 20, 30 minutes towards the end.
Yeah. Okay.
And then you just either you're brought onto her side or, you know, you see that she's actually been the evil one the entire time. I feel like the way it was done was relatively weak to the point where I would have preferred there was just no twist at all. I feel like a lot of people, especially with M. Night Shyamalan movies, let twists ruin movies for them, which is really fucking stupid. It's less than 1% of the movie, and you're going to let it ruin the movie for you. And the fact that I really didn't care for that twist does not change the other 2 hours of the movie for me.
Yeah, I really liked the twist. I thought it was great.
Well, I saw it coming like from the get-go. So
I didn't. I'm a little dumb. Yeah. But And I really enjoyed it because, like, throughout the whole movie, like, it was pissing me off throughout the whole movie. Like, why is nobody trying to kill Lupita? Like, all the other doppelgangers, nobody's trying to kill her, but everybody mm-hmm. else is killing everybody else, and it doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah.
And then you find out at the end why they aren't, because Lupita wants to kill Lupita.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, okay. 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 I get it now. Okay. Oh.
Yeah.
I'm still a little pissed off, but
yeah.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, I get it.
I feel like I would have liked that more if it was shown in the beginning. You know, you saw... Like, it would have been, I think it would have been better not as a twist, where you see that the doppelganger kidnaps her and throws her down with the other doppelgangers in the beginning when she's like 4 or 5 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And then the rest of the movie is her just trying to come back and, you know, get her life back. I really feel like it would have been better not as a twist, just part of the story.
Yeah.
But you know what, it is what it is. Like I said, it's not enough to ruin. It's still my favorite movie of at least the past 10 years so far. So I'm nitpicking here, but I think it was definitely one of the weaker points.
Yeah. I can understand it. It's an acceptable claim.
Mm-hmm. But that's also because, like, I called it. I was just, it would have been better if they didn't show in the trailer the doppelganger kid, Lupita Nyong'o, strangling the regular Lupita Nyong'o.
Yeah, they did. See, I try not to watch trailers anymore. Just because.
But, I mean, they showed it, but they didn't tell you who she was. So okay. When it was revealed that that kid was Lupita Nyong'o, I was like, oh, okay.
Oh, that ruins it. That sucks.
Yeah. But, you know, again, just nitpicking. Mm-hmm. It's still a fantastic movie.
Some of my favorite I've seen a long parts time. About this movie is just, like, the white people jokes that they have. I guess it's some white people shit. I live for that shit. Just kick us down. I love it. It's hilarious.
Yeah.
Like, I don't even remember what the context was, but, it was when... they had the spare key on the ground.
Oh, and, the Heida key.
Yeah, the Heida key. He's like, Heida key? That's some white people shit or something like that. And just, that made me laugh so hard.
That, I mean, it's true. Like, the fact that anyone has a Heida key is dumb to me. I always thought it was dumb. Like, what? And you're going to hide it in a fake rock?
Yeah.
That is obviously fake? What's wrong with it?
Especially it's on the walkway, too. So that's...
Yeah.
I mean, that was fun. Obviously, that's just one of the moments. The comedic timing throughout this whole movie is just so good.
Yeah. And I think that's where, you know, Jordan Peele lets his comedy come out. Like, especially in the later years of Key and Peele, mm-hmm. you see his horror coming through his comedy.
Yeah.
Like, with the Make-A-Wish skit. I don't know if you've seen that.
Probably not.
Where it's like this possessed kid who's just like the Make-A-Wish Foundation comes to him and he's trying to like wish for really fucked up shit.
We at the Make-A-Wish Foundation make dreams come true for little boys and little girls who are very sick, just like you.
There are no children like me, Marion Glass.
Oh, of course not. You're one of a kind, but we're gonna make any dream come true that you could ever have.
I wish to drown a man.
What?
To drown a man in the bathtub. To hold him down while the last breath escapes his body and then bathe in that water, all the while singing, la, 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 la,
la. And so it was just like the horror came out in the comedy, but now the comedy's coming out in the horror.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, this movie did get me really excited to see his Twilight Zone stuff.
I think it's Twilight Zone. I think he's just the host and narrator, but
regardless,
and probably producer, but I'm really excited for it.
I'm going to watch it just because of that.
Yeah, me too.
I don't want to say too much about this. Yeah. I know we're in spoilers here, but still, I don't want to talk too much about it. People should definitely see this goddamn movie.
If by some chance you have come this far in the podcast without seeing us, go see it regardless. It is just masterfully made, and you will still probably be able to enjoy it knowing everything that's that we said here today. Mm-hmm. So.
Like, I'm definitely probably going to watch it again.
Oh, I'm going to watch it at least two more times.
Yeah.
I plan on going on Wednesday. And yeah, maybe even tonight. I don't know. We'll see.
Zora, put your shoes on.
If you want to get crazy, we can get crazy.
What are you people?
It's us.
They look exactly like us. They think like us. They know where we are. We need to move and keep moving. They won't stop until they kill us. Or we kill them.
Let's talk about these shelf boys. So, as you all know, to make it to the KFR shelf, there must be a unanimous decision by both Glenn and myself. So, Glenn, let's talk about Triple Frontier.
Let's talk about Triple Frontier. So, for me, I think I already know your decision here. I think I enjoyed this movie enough to want to put it on the shelf. I really enjoyed the cinematography. I did like the characterization for most of them. I understood some of the things they did. There was obviously the one part where Ben Affleck did the 180 I didn't like, but I understood why they did it and the end result of his actions, why they did that. But I mean, other than that, I had a good time with this movie. I didn't hate it. I think I'd want to put it on the shelf maybe, but I already think I know you don't want to.
Unfortunately, you are correct. I think it's a good movie. It's definitely worth a watch. It's not one I would recommend a lot. I try to think of the shelf as movies I would recommend constantly.
That's where I want to throw that game that I was talking about. Like me and a couple of buddies played that game together. So I'd be like, yo guys, you gotta watch this movie. If you like playing this game with me, I swear to God, you'll like this movie.
Yeah. I'm kind of curious if I played that game, if I would like this movie. Yeah, more.
I doubt it. I thought I said, if you already had, I'm like, you definitely didn't play this game.
No. If I did play this game, if I would like it more,
if I knew you'd like games, I would play it with you, but
yeah, well, I'm a poor boy. Nobody loves me. He's just a poor boy from a poor family. but anyway, yeah, I think especially with this director, J.C. Shandor, he's got a lot of better movies that I would prefer to be on the shelf. Not to say that, you know, directors can't have multiple movies on the shelf, but especially after seeing that he directed those other movies, this is definitely a disappointment for me. So I'm going to say no for the shelf.
I also kind of want to know, like, if Netflix had their hands in it. Like, I mean, obviously they did, but I want to know how much they did and how much it probably could have been better if they hadn't.
Yeah.
But, you know, we'll never know. We'll also never know what the main cast would have looked like if it was other people.
Yeah, definitely. Anyway, so Triple Frontier does not make it onto the shelf. Let's move on to The Autopsy of Jane Doe. Mm-hmm. This movie creeped me out more than any horror movie. Even with Us, like, Us didn't creep me out, but The Autopsy of Jane Doe did, made me paranoid. I thought it was really well made. I liked the scientific aspect that they went down. Like, they didn't just automatically assume it was ghosts or, you know, witches or whatever.
Yeah.
The chemistry between Brian Cox and Emile Hirsch is impeccable. They did a really good job at keeping it interesting with only two characters. You know, I could just go on about everything they did right. So with that being said, I would say this does deserve to be on the shelf.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
I would say I'm going to copy all your speech and then paste it. Just do it in my voice. Except the only thing that really pissed me off was jump scares. I hate jump scares. I hate, not because they scare me and because they're jumpy, but because they're stupid and dumb. And for that, I'm going to put it on the shelf.
I knew it was going to go that way. I knew. But yeah, I would agree. The jump scares are always
the
a bit
jump
much.
Scares are really the only things that hold it back.
Yeah, it really, like, if they changed every jump scare and just had the slow reveal, it would be much better. But Autopsy Jane Doe does make it onto the shelf. Let's get into Us.
I don't think we really have to talk too much about that.
Yes, it goes on the shelf.
There you go. Two shelf
boys. The thing about this is I know there is probably jump scares in this movie, but they're done in a way that I don't notice them.
Yeah.
Like
even the ones you expect a jump scare, like, it's just it's just like, what it should be.
The most memorable thing I can think of is when the kids are trying to go save their mom in Tim Heidecker's character's house.
Mm-hmm.
The doppelgangers of his twin daughters are like running around and they got the two main kids have weapons, and while what happens could be classified as a jump scare, they build it up enough where you know it's going to happen. So really, if you jumped during it, you weren't paying attention.
Oh, there were so many people jumping in my theater. It was hilarious.
Yeah. I always sit in the front, so I don't even notice if people are jumping. But like, you see one of the characters, she's like doing a handstand, and then she comes out of the handstand quietly and then screams and goes to attack them. But like, what happens there could be classified as a jump scare. But if you didn't see it coming, you're a dummy.
Yeah.
You're a big old dummy. But did you say if Us deserves to go on the shelf? I can't remember.
What is this, joke time?
Yeah, no, I just don't know if I cut you off. Anyway, so.
I said I think we already know what this is going to be. Yeah, and then you're like, yeah,
that's right.
Yeah.
The Triple Frontier does not make it on the shelf. The Autopsy of Jane Doe and Jordan Peele's Us do make it onto the shelf.
Okie dokie.
So that's it for this week. We got two more movies for next week. Glenn. Actually, no, I always make you go first.
No. I want to explain what the deal here is first before you go.
Okay.
So, I have noticed in the past that we do a lot of kind of whatever we want to pick. So, I had sent Mike a text here saying, hey, we should give some attention to these genres. So, we're gonna pick some movies from those genres this time around. What they are,
somewhat.
Hey, it's a big freaking mystery to you. But to me, I was like, hey, we'll give them attention. We'll give them a little bit. Just for those heartthrobs out there, here you go. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. So I kind of went with that. I searched through the genres you said. Most of those movies did not pique my interest at all, except for one. It was in the crime genre, but it also could be classified as horror, but it looks... I don't know which way it's going to go, but I did look for crime, and this is 1922.
Oh, that's the name of the movie. I always like,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, the name of the movie is 1922, written and directed by
Zach. Made in 92. Oh boy.
1922. I don't know if I said 92, but Zach Hilditch, and then it's based on the novel by Stephen King, starring Thomas Jane, Molly Parker, Dylan Schmid, and Catherine Bernard. It tells the story of a simple yet proud farmer in the year 1922 conspires to murder his wife for financial gain, convincing his teenage son to assist, but their actions have unintended consequences. That is available on Netflix. Netflix sponsor us. And yeah.
So this is one that I've wanted to talk about just with you. We're a Glenn's Day, but I never got around to doing it. I love this movie. I really enjoy this movie. I don't know how you'll feel about it, but regardless, we're going to talk about it. Mine is on Netflix as well. Please sponsor us.
Netflix sponsor us.
Come on. So mine stars Jared Leto, Sarah Polley, Diane Kruger, and Lin Dan Pham, and is directed by Jacques Van Dormael. It's called Mr. Nobody.
Mr. Nobody. I've been wanting to watch that, but it is so long that I
really enjoy this movie a lot.
That's good to know.
We'll see.
Interesting. So
it's all over the place. So get ready for that.
Oh, you know me. I'm fine with movies that are all over the place.
Yeah.
The less I can predict, the better. But yeah, I'm looking forward to watching that now that I have a reason to. Next week's movies are 1922 and Mr. Nobody, both available on Netflix. Netflix sponsor us.
Come on.
You can follow us on Instagram at Keystone_film_review or on Facebook at Keystone Film Review. On Letterboxd, I am Mike KFR.
And I'm Glenn KFR.
And that will do it for this week. Thank you for watching, listening, and diddling. What? Okay, that's enough. Bye.